Hello, my name is Ryan Boyd, and this is your Intro to Graph Databases series, episode 3 on graph modeling. The first question you probably have when talking about graph modeling is, what does a graph look like? Well, this is very simple. A graph looks like the real world. We like to say with Neo4j and graph databases that the whiteboard model is the physical model. When your business folks gather in a conference room, the same thing that they draw up on the whiteboard to represent your business objects is the exact same thing that a developer codes in the application, and the same way that the data is stored in the underlying database on disk. This lack of translation friction between the different parties here makes it a lot faster to build your applications and a lot easier to maintain them. So let's start off with a very simple relationship. Let's say that we have Ann loves Dan. In this case, we actually have two nodes. We have a node representing Ann and a node representing Dan. And we have the loves relationship in between the two. Now, relationships are directional. So when Ann loves Dan, if Ann is lucky enough, Dan loves Ann back. And because this isn't always true, we would likely represent this as two separate relationships, one for Ann loving Dan and one for Dan loving Ann. We'll talk later about the case where the relationships are always bidirectional and how you might want to represent those. But first, let's give you a little bit more information about the property graph. So the property graph is named as such because it allows you to store properties along with your nodes and relationships. Let's start off with a simple graph that we already did, where we have Ann loving Dan and Dan loving Ann. We can easily, on the fly, add a new relationship. So Ann lives with Dan. We can add this relationship quite easily because Neo4j is schema optional. You can easily adapt to your business in an agile way to add new relationships and properties. Okay, so we have these three relationships. Now what's next? Well, I called it the property graph, so let's add some properties. In this case here, we want to represent the name of Ann and the name of Dan in addition to their birth date. But you can see here we have a third property on Ann, which is her Twitter handle. This property only exists on Ann, and that's fine. You can have a property just existing on a single node. Now let's show you how we add an additional relationship and an additional node. In this case here, we want to represent that Dan owns this car. And we can represent some properties on this car as well, like the make and the model. Now what happens if we want some additional relationships? Well, we easily just add them. In this case, we add the relationship that Ann drives this car, and Dan also drives this car. But these relationships can have properties as well. So we can add a very simple property as to when Dan started owning the car and when Ann started driving the car. All right, well, that is a very simple property graph for you. You have the nodes, you have the relationships, and you have the properties on both the nodes and the relationships. We also call it a labeled property graph for a reason, because we can have labels on each of our nodes. These labels are kind of like types. It allows you to indicate what type of node we are representing. So in this case here, Dan and Ann are both person nodes. And Dan also has this car that we're going to call a car node. But we can also add a more generic label to the car that is a vehicle. So in the case of multiple different types of vehicles, you might have trucks or cars or boats, and you might put all of those with the label vehicle in addition to having their more specific label. We've reviewed now our nodes, our relationships, the properties on each of the nodes and relationships, as well as the labels on the nodes. Now, how does this map to the English language? Well, quite easily. We like to say that you're representing the real world with your graph model. And because you're representing the real world, you can use the English language or whatever other spoken language that you have to talk about these objects. So in this case here, we have our nodes, and those nodes are the nouns in our language. Very simple here. And then we have our properties. And those properties are the adjectives that describe those nouns. And then we have our relationships. Those relationships are our verbs. And then we have the properties on the relationships, and those are our adverbs. This is a quite simple way to think about how you should model your data, is making sure as you walk the graph, as you traverse the graph that you've modeled, can you speak about it using either the English language or the language of your choice? Now I'm going to give you a very basic tutorial on using Cypher with this graph. Now Cypher, if you remember from the earlier videos, is our declarative query language, which you used to work with the graph. You can use Cypher both for creating things in the graph as well as for querying them. Now let's give you an example. Let's say that we wanted to create this data that represents that Anne loves Dan. This is quite a simple Cypher statement. We simply say create, and we say the label of our node. In this case, it is a person labeled node. And we say the properties, sort of like in JSON syntax. In this case, name is Anne. And then we say that that node loves another node, a person whose name is Dan. It's very simple to create this in one single line of Cypher. Now, if we did want to represent bi-directionality, if we had something like a Facebook friend relationship, where if you know, a Facebook friend relationship always exists in both directions. In that case, we would probably represent it in the graph just in a single direction, as in this case, Anne FB friends Dan. And that is just indicating perhaps that Anne was the one that initiated the friend request. Now we can match that relationship just in that direction by saying person, name is Anne, arrow, FB friends, another arrow, the person whose name is Dan. And you can notice here that Cypher uses what we call ASCII art for graphs. You're literally drawing the pattern of the graph in your query through ASCII characters, like the greater than symbol. But what if we want to find the relationships regardless of who initiated the relationship? We just want to find all people who are friends in our graph. Well, you can easily do that by omitting the greater than symbol, by omitting the directionality of the relationship when querying the data. So the relationship always has to exist in a specific direction when you create it in Cypher, but when you query it, you can match regardless of the direction. Well, that's all for today. Thank you very much for enjoying this episode 3 of the Intro to Graph Databases series. Up next, we're going to go into some more detail about graphs and how perhaps they map to your existing knowledge about relational databases. Thank you very much and have a fantastic day.